can't find the words to say how much it hurts. You are the healing in my heart. When all that I can see are broken memories, you are the light that's in the dark. If I had no tongue, I would dance for you like the rising sun. And when that day comes and I see your face, I will shout your endless glorious praise. If I
Good morning, church. Let's stand, let's worship this morning.
Well, good morning, everybody. It's good to see everybody kind of mingling there just a little bit. Love it. Hey, I want to welcome everybody that may be watching online today as well. And if you are new to the church, you can go ahead and be seated. If you are new to the church, you can... my mind got sidetracked there. My granddaughter was waving at me, and so I was waving back. Oh, now the other one's waving. Anyway, if you are new to the church, really glad you're here. And on your way out today, you can stop by the connection counter, which is just where you came in. Love to give you a gift for being our guest here today. One of the things I wanted to mention, this is Fifth Sunday, so all of the kids are in here today, okay? So we're just having a family worship service. You know, I was thinking, oh man, back when I was with my parents, we all sat there like on the second row, and we all had to sit together. I had the three brothers, then another one came along. No, there's three of us. I'm the fourth one. I got that wrong. So anyway, we all had to sit in the same row, you know? And there wasn't even such thing as children's church or, you know, the youth meeting upstairs. So it's great to just have a family Sunday. We can all be in here together. Listen, I'm going to pray. Oh, I would mention the connection card real quick. all in the bulletins that are out there for you. Fill in a prayer, a praise, whatever you want. Put it up here in the offering plate a little later on in the service. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for today. It's just an opportunity, God, where we get to get together as your family. And we get to worship you. Father, I pray that you would really help us to concentrate on you. Help us to be challenged by you. Help us to sing in a way that represents a heart that is just glad to be here and to be known as your child and a part of your family. Lord, I pray too for all the people that surrounds this church. Lord, there are people out there that need to know you. There are people out there that need help. And God, I pray that as your people, that we would be able to do something to reach them. But God, just help your church everywhere to reach people for you. Lord, we're thankful for the gift of eternal life that we have through your Son. And boy, may we be forever grateful. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We have all we need in you, and all we need is you. All we need is you. Church, sing that again. All we need in you, and all we need is you. All we need is you. Rich or poor, God, I want you more than anything that glitters in this world. Be my all consuming fire. You can have all my hands can hold, my heart, my strength and soul. Be my all consuming fire. For we have all. We have all we need in you. You can have a seat.
Good morning, everyone. You know, today we're going to have another in Kendall's series that he's been talking about how to mess up your life. That's my version of it. And I'm finding it quite interesting, to be quite honest. It's really caused some introspection for me to see what I do that kind of messes my life up. And I just think it's been really good. Today he's going to talk about, you know, how to live in disarray, in a mess. And so I got to thinking about that a little bit, and what is the opposite of that? What is, we need to live in the joy of being saved, of Jesus Christ. We need to be full of that joy, because that joy brings a peace that passes all understanding to us. So as you listen to the message today, I hope you'll think about that. One of the things that I was thinking, one of the things that causes joy in me is when I come to this table to take communion, what's it really meaning, you know? And to me, it's a place where I can find refreshment for the next week. It's a place where I can pray that my sins will be forgiven, Father, where I have fallen short during the week. And so it refreshes me, knowing that I can walk away from there being as white as driven snow if I really mean it, and if I really am turning my life back over to Christ and saying, come, Lord Jesus. So today when you approach, remember, we're going to be refreshed. We're going to find that peace. We're going to find that joy. as we partake of the elements. For those of you that are visiting us today, we have our four different stations in the four corners where you can take communion with us and a place to deposit any off.
Holy Father, we just thank you so much for this time where we can come together and we can enjoy the meal that you have put before us together. The body of Christ and the blood of Christ. And Father, these are just symbols where it helps us to reflect. And we can think about what the meaning behind it is. Or it's not the symbol itself that is our saving grace, but it is your grace that you have given to us where we find that salvation. And it's through the blood of Christ and through the body of Christ that was so beaten, where he wasn't even recognizable. Your one and only Son that you sent because you love us that much. Father, I thank you so much for that love, that unconditional love, where a lot of times we can't understand that and we can't wrap our minds around what unconditional love actually is. But Father, you show us that daily because we fall short every single day. We can try and try and try our hardest to be perfect, but it's impossible because we're human. But the most beautiful part about your story is your grace. Your grace and your peace that you put upon us, it surpasses all understanding. We can't wrap our mind around it. Father, I just come to you now, and I'm so grateful for that peace that you give us and for that grace that covers everything, all of the junk that we hold on to a lot of times. Father, help us to remember that as your child, that is our identity. Our identity is in Christ and in Christ alone, no matter what. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains
good.
shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. You are forever
mine. Well, we've been in a kind of a unique series where I'm telling you to do the exact opposite of what you'd want to do. But I've enjoyed it. I've enjoyed kind of thinking in that way because it challenges all of us uniquely. Coleman and Kelsey, okay, that's my son-in-law and my daughter. They recently became proud new parents of a fantastic, beautiful, wonderful. Is that how we talk about our grandkids? Yeah. And her name is Paisley. Now, a few months before Paisley was born, Coleman and Kelsey, they found out that it was going to be a girl. And they shared the news with Gracie, 5 years old, and Charlie, my other granddaughter, 3 years old. Now, all along, okay, Gracie, she wanted a girl. And all along, Charlie wanted a boy, or a papa, as she often called it, because she loves her papa. So that's boy, papa's boy, okay? So I'm just going to play this video that they took when they made this announcement to the kids.
So today, Mommy had an appointment, and Daddy was there. And they told us what we're going to have. Gracie, what do you think the baby is in Mommy's belly, boy or girl?
Girl.
Charlie, what do you think the baby is in Mommy's belly, boy or girl?
A boy.
Boy?
Yeah.
Okay, well, on the count of three, we're going to tell you what is in Mommy's belly, a boy or a girl. Okay, you guys going to count with me? Okay, one, two, three. It's a...
Girl!
We're going to have a girl.
It's okay. Aww.
It's okay, Charlie. You don't want a baby girl?
No.
And Papa.
No, I want a boy.
Why?
Because you went to Papa again.
Well, you get to be a big sister.
When is it going to come out?
That is the picture of dissatisfaction, okay? It really is. Now, I think about the reaction of my three-year-old granddaughter, okay? It may not be as prominent or emotional in adults, but I think there are a lot of people out there that live this way. I mean, someone got a better paying job, you know, than I did, and that's just not fair. And so your head's all down, you know, and you're feeling envious, and bitterness begins to develop in the heart. Well, they got a brand new car, you know, and I'm still driving this piece of junk. I mean, woe is me. And you begin to compare, and you begin to complain, and an ungrateful disposition begins to grow in your heart. I mean, why did God let this happen to me? It's just not fair. And so you begin to wallow in some self-pity. You wallow in some blame, and a sour attitude begins to develop in you. Take Adam and Eve, for example, here. You know, in the Old Testament book of Genesis, It tells how God created them, God placed them in the Garden of Eden, and everything was totally perfect. Now think about that. Everything was perfect. I mean, God supplied every need that they had to survive, and life was great under the protection and provision of God. But somewhere along the line, okay, they begin to think, well, you know, it sure would be nice to eat some of that fruit that God told us not to eat. Oh, and Satan's temptation and a lack of contentment and the desire for something more. Well, it influenced the outcome of their life. Now, this message today is all about a game plan, okay? This is about a game plan to live an unfulfilled, a complaining, a grumpy, a griping, a fault-finding, a belly-aching, crabby, jealous, envious, unhappy, and dissatisfied life. Now, I'm not sure if that's what you want to do, okay, but I've got a game plan for that, okay? There is hope. You can live a dissatisfied life. You can be just like Charlie, with a horrible look on your face for the rest of your life, okay? I mean, doesn't that sound good? Now, let me give you a game plan to live dissatisfied, okay? And if you haven't been here for the past 3 weeks, okay, in this series, I have a tendency to get just a little bit sarcastic, so I want you to be aware of that. Here's game plan number one. In order to live a dissatisfied life, make it your personal goal to be ungrateful, okay? Be ungrateful. Bible says in Hebrews 12:28, therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us be thankful and so worship God acceptably with reverence and awe. Now, folks, I know the Bible there, it tells us to be thankful because we are a part of a spiritual kingdom, okay, that will not be shaken. It is secure. It'll never pass away. But don't do that, all right? I just want you all to be grateful. To be great at being ungrateful. Do I hear an amen? Okay. The Bible says in 1 Timothy 3, 1 to 2, it says, you should know this, Timothy, that in the last days, okay, in the last days, at that time all the way now until Jesus comes back, there will be very difficult times. For people will love only themselves and their money. They will be boastful and proud, scoffing at God, disobedient to their parents, and ungrateful. Okay, there it is, folks. Yes, be ungrateful. I mean, if you own a car, I want you all to just be ungrateful that you got that car, because only 10% of the world's population even owns a car. If you're a family of four and you only make $50,000 a year, then be ungrateful for that, because you are among the top 11% of the entire world when it comes to income. If you have good health, be ungrateful. If you have a job, be ungrateful. If you got a Christmas bonus but it wasn't enough, is like what you thought it should be ungrateful. If God blesses someone else and he doesn't seem to be blessing you, be ungrateful. It's going to help you to live the most dissatisfied life you could ever live. Here's game plan number two. Compare everything you have to those who have more. In Galatians 6, 4 and 5, it says, pay careful attention to your own work, for then you will get the satisfaction of a job well done, and you won't need to compare yourself to anyone else, for we are each responsible for our own conduct. All right, now don't worry about any kind of self-evaluation. Don't worry about taking responsibility for your own actions. Just compare yourself to others and see where you rank. Allow envy begin to grow in your heart. Hey, allow jealousy to take over. Oh, personal ambition, you know, to become a driving force in your life. And compare and compare and compare. That way, you can just be ungrateful and dissatisfied instead of content. So go ahead, folks. Compare your car to somebody else's car. Compare your salary to somebody else's salary. Compare your house to somebody else's house and your clothes to their clothes and your lifestyle to their lifestyle. And if you think of anything else that you would like to compare, just go ahead and do it. It'll all lead to a dissatisfied life. Game plan number three, live for the sake of acquiring possessions. You know, Jesus had something to say about that. Luke 12:15, he said, watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions. All right, now don't make that your Bible verse to live by. Maybe you need to live more by this message, okay? Money is not everything, but it ranks right up there with oxygen, okay? Put me on some money oxygen right now. I need it, folks. I want it. I love it. Live your life for all the stuff on the earth. And don't worry about being greedy. Just make life about the here and now, the abundance of possessions, and you will live a dissatisfied life. Game plan number four, always resent God for your lot in life. Psalm 43:2. You know, some of the Psalms are kind of interesting in what they say. Now, there's a lot more to the Psalm, but I think you need to make this verse one you embrace and you live by. It's Psalm 43:2, okay? You are God, my stronghold. Why have you rejected me? Why must I go about mourning, oppressed by the enemy? Here's another verse to embrace from Psalm 22:1-2. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from my cries of anguish? My God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, by night, but I find no rest. Okay, God, it's your fault, right? I mean, I resent that you have rejected me. I resent that you just made me cry all night long. And God, it's your fault. I resent how you don't hear my cry and you don't answer my prayers. You know, it's possible that right now in life there have been some twists and turns. And life has left you unmarried. Life has left you divorced. Financially struggling. You're anxious. You're stressed out. You're unhealthy. You've lost a job. Relationship problems. Well, folks, just go ahead and resent God for your lot in life. Because I got some good news. It'll help you live the most dissatisfied life you could ever live in this world. Oh, and that is what you want, right? A dissatisfied life. I mean, you're speaking my language. Let's all put our hands in right now. Just go ahead and put your hand out for the fun of it, okay? Just for the fun of it. 1, 2, 3. Dissatisfied. I'm all in, right? Game plan number 5, develop an attitude of entitlement. The Bible says in James 3:16, for where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder in every evil practice. Well, I'm not so sure about, you know, that stuff of disorder and evil practice, but, you know, out of envy and selfish ambition, I deserve it. I mean, I work hard, okay, and I deserve that new position at work. Now, I know the budget is tight, but I really do deserve that new purse. I deserve that new boat. I deserve that 82-inch screen TV. Happened to be at Sam's Club in Wentzville yesterday. Man, they've got a really nice-looking brand-new TV there. Wow. I think I deserve that. Now, I don't work much and I don't make much, but I deserve to go on that $3,000 trip, you know. I deserve all the free stuff I can get. It's my right. I did not study 1 minute for that test, and I failed it. Woo, but I deserve a second chance. Well, I'm kind of glad that this series of messages is over with. Because I've been telling you to live the exact opposite of what God's Word tells you to live. But maybe in doing that, it has helped you to identify something, one or two things in your life that really needs to change. Let me just give you a glimpse into a better path to follow than the one I described, okay? Here's path number one. Instead of being dissatisfied with everything, we need to be content. Here's what the Bible tells us in 1 Timothy 6:6-8. But godliness, okay, listen to this first part, but godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. You know, when things don't go your way in life, okay, and maybe things are not measuring up like you had expected, it is rather easy to fall into a pattern of negativity. And, you know, you begin to complain about something. You're envious of somebody else. There's this fault finding going on. You're comparing, okay? You're living dissatisfied, but that's not the kind of lifestyle God wants you to live. Because it all leads to a miserable existence. That's exactly how Satan wants you to live, but it's not how God wants you to live. You know, you're so focused on you and yours and mine that you just end up living a dissatisfied life. Now, a better path from the passage I just read is to approach life from a position of godliness with contentment, okay? Think about that. Godliness with contentment. Well, what does that mean? It means that you're going to make a choice to pursue God's moral standards with a common sense understanding that, you know what, I didn't bring anything into this world and I can't take nothing with me when I die. It means that we pursue to choose God's moral standards with a heart of contentment that says, you know what, if I just have the basic necessities of life, I will be satisfied. I will be happy. I'm going to be at ease and content with that. Well, now, how can that really happen in life? It's because godliness and contentment are working together. And that kind of combination, God and contentment, it leads to great gain for your personal life, okay? And so instead of living dissatisfied, you're going to live with contentment. You're not going to be ungrateful, but content. You're not going to be comparing yourself to everybody else. You're going to be content. You're not resenting God, but you're content and looking for lessons that God may want to teach you. One commentator noted this: contentment was a significant term among the Stoic and Cynic philosophers. For them, it meant self-sufficiency, the ability to grit one's teeth and bear whatever fate delivered. As Phi, and that's another very, that's another commentator that's very well known, and Phi has noted, he turned the tables on the Stoics by declaring that genuine contentment is not self-sufficiency, but Christ-sufficiency. You know that verse out of Philippians 4:13, I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength. And so through Jesus, we can effectively lead a life of contentment. Another glimpse into a better path to follow is this: instead of being rich toward possessions, we need to be rich toward God. Now, I'm going to read a parable, a story that Jesus told. In fact, I'm going to preach on this text next week. We're starting a new series, but I'm using this parable next week. We're just going to barely touch it. But here's what Jesus said. He said, watch out, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in the abundance of possessions. And he told them this parable. The ground of a certain rich man yield an abundant harvest. He thought to himself, what shall I do? I have no place to store my crops. Then he said, this is what I'll do. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones. And there I will store my surplus grain. And I'll say to myself, you have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy. Eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, you fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves but is not rich toward God. In this story Jesus told, here was a man who was just storing up more and more, building bigger and bigger, and selfishly just keeping it all to himself. And from the story of Jesus, it's rather obvious that this man was concerned about his possessions a whole lot more than he was ever concerned about being rich toward God. And what does being rich toward God mean? Well, it means that all these possessions that we have in this life, they're secondary. They're less important. And it means that God is the greatest priority. In his autobiography, Just As I Am, Billy Graham, he tells a story in his book that really reveals who's really rich, the most rich person of all. He tells how, at that time, some years back, Billy Graham and his wife Ruth, they went to an island in the Caribbean, and one of the wealthiest men in the world actually invited them to have some lunch at his very lavish home. This guy was close to 75 years old. And Mr. Graham, he talks about how through this whole meal, this man seemed to be almost on the verge of tears. Here's what the man said. I am the most miserable person in the world. Out there is my yacht. I can go anywhere I want to. I have a private plane. I have my helicopters. I have everything I want to make my life happy, but I am as miserable as, and he used an explicative. And so Billy Graham talks about how, hey, they talked with him, they prayed with him, they tried to point him to Christ and let him know that, hey, lasting meaning comes from Jesus. Then after it was all over with, Mr. Graham and his wife, they went down the hill to a small cottage that they were staying in. And that afternoon, a local minister happened to stop by and just visit for a bit. And he too was a widower. And he spent most of his time taking care of his two invalid sisters. He was full of enthusiasm. He was full of love for Christ and others. And this local minister said, well, I don't have £2 to my name. Or we might say, I don't have $2 to my name. But I am the happiest man on this island. And after they left, Billy Graham turned to his wife Ruth and said, who do you think is the richer man? Well, his wife didn't even have to answer because they both knew the answer to that question. You know, if you want to live the richest life you could ever live in this world, then make sure you really are rich toward God. Possessions will never make you as happy as a relationship with God, the one who created all of those things. You will always live a more satisfied life with God than you will ever live on your own. So my question is, are you living a rich and satisfying life? We're going to bow our heads and I'm going to pray and we're going to get ready for our decision song today. Dear Heavenly Father, if there is anybody here that's living a life of dissatisfaction, I pray that you would help them to see a different way. It's my prayer that you would help them to find you. Lord, help anybody here that needs to just see how a lasting meaning, a lasting satisfaction, a lasting peace is going to be found in a relationship with you and your Son, Jesus. God, may we look to you as we live this life. May we never try to live it on our own. Help us to make a connection to you and your Son. Because it will truly make a huge difference. Help people to discover you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, folks, as we went through this series on losing your faith, committing adultery, becoming addicted, and living dissatisfied, I hope that you have been able to just find, you know, one or two things in your life that really needs to change. And I would ask, what is that one or two things for you? And whatever those are, I would ask that you consider making a decision to genuinely and deeply repent of your sin. And that you would now go a different direction. That you would change. I mean, just don't listen to all of this, you know, and then leave and not change one thing. I'd like you to move in a different direction with Jesus, and I will say that with Jesus is the key. When you choose Jesus, I sincerely believe that you will find more than enough in Him to change the whole trajectory of your life. We've come to our decision time, and if you do have a decision, hey, I invite you to come back. If you need prayer in your life, I invite you to come back, and one of our decision counselors will be glad to pray with you. Okay, let's go ahead and stand, and let's sing our decision song today.
You're the center of the universe. Everything was made in you, Jesus. Breath of every living thing, everyone was made for you. You hold everything together. You hold everything together. Oh, Christ, be the center of our lives. Be the place we fix our eyes. Be the center of our lives. You're center of the universe. Everything was made in you, Jesus. Breath of every living thing, everyone was made for you. You hold everything together. You hold the center of our lives. Well, before we finish out our time together, we just have one more announcement to make, and that is next week we have our annual FYI and Thanksgiving meal together. Hey, we're excited about that. Absolutely. That starts at 5 next week. So after service, go home, take a little nap, and get ready to eat all of the delicious foods. Yes? Yes. So we said amen. That's right. All right, let's finish out our time together this morning.
Waited for this day, we're gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, burn our hearts with truth. And you're the reason we're here, and you're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Filling every part of our praise. Your presence in this place, you gather on our face, looking into the sky. Descending like a cloud, standing with us now, Lord, unveil our eyes. And you're the reason we're here, you're the reason we're seeing. You open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart and filling every part of our praise. Oh, open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart and filling. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord.
Church, we will see you next Sunday.